And all of God's people said amen.
Amen.
Bear with me this morning. It's been a long week of work and church and study and life. But I'm thankful God has given us this space and time that we may come together.
Amen.
And refresh each other in fellowship. And to receive his engrafted word.
Amen.
I'm appreciative that God is using all of us in some way, somehow, to promote the kingdom of God.
Amen.
I'm eternally thankful that we walk in and we are in the blood that binds us all together. And that is that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, died on Calvary's cross for all of our sins,
amen,
that we may have a right to the tree of life.
Amen.
And for that, the whole church ought to say amen.
Amen.
This morning, I want to talk with you from the subject matter, what's leading you?
Mm-hmm.
What's leading you? Because I believe very richly that there is a spiritual world. If you ever heard me preach, you know that I believe that there's a spiritual world. And that things move about and they take place reactionary to the things that are in the flesh. And the fruit of, the end product of, is a combination of the direction that we have been in all through the week. And so sometime in my travel, sometime in my life, I don't like the destination that I end up in. But I realize that I only end up there because I activated the spiritual realm. And God's destiny is promised by his word, and that is, whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap.
Amen.
And so in my flesh, I wrestle with the idea sometimes that perhaps God has failed me, only to come to a conclusion that it is only I have failed myself. And even in days that I over-glorify myself and feel that I have done thus and I have done that, I realize I am absolutely nothing. But it is the power of God, because God had said in his word that if you sow into the Spirit, ye shall reap of the Spirit. Then I am left to review everything and to say that God has given every one of us a choice, rather to reap the things of the Spirit or to reap the things of the flesh. And so my question to you this morning is, what in the world is leading you?
Amen.
Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor,
amen,
the preacher is going to talk about what's leading you. Amen. If you have your copies of God's manuscript, his map to heaven, if you'll turn to Galatians chapter 5 and begin at verse number 617, that should suffice us. We will get right into this lesson. And I hope that something that is said will bless your life, and that you'll be able to take from here into the week and be encouraged by and motivated by to consider the word of God as a guide, an instrumental tool that will help you through various challenges that you will certainly face when you walk out this door. The Bible says in the book of Galatians chapter 5, beginning at verse number 16, this I say then, walk in the Spirit. And that is a directive tense, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusts against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary to one another, so that you cannot do. Underscore, you cannot do what you would. There is a war for leadership that takes place and trumps the physical leadership by manifesting the spiritual leadership. The war is not in Afghanistan. It is not in Jerusalem. The war is not even on the streets of San Diego, but the war that many of you have not decided to arm yourself with happens on the inside of the mind. He says that there's a war in which the flesh wars against the spirit. And the spirit don't just stand there and take it. Amen. But the spirit fights back against the flesh. I'm aware that I am a spirit. I live in
the flesh.
But I possess a soul. I realize that when God said in the book of Genesis, chapter 1, verse number 16, that let us make God in our own image, that I am not remedial enough to think that he has two legs and two arms, but that God made us in his image and his likeness, in which God is three persons in one. And that God is the water, the spirit, and blood, as man is flesh, soul, and spirit. Are you with me? You see, a lot of times we read the scriptures and we say, well, God made us in his own image, and we look in the mirror and say, God looks something like me. God don't look, I don't know what God looked like. He don't look nothing like you. But we are designed in three persons in one, in that I am a spirit. God, John 4:24, is a spirit. 1 John 5, around verse number 7, there are three that bear witness in heaven, the water, the blood, and the spirit. And I am made of flesh, I am made of spirit, and I have a soul. And the Bible says in 2 Corinthians 5 and verse number 6 that the spirit, when we're absent from the body, that the spirit goes back to be present from which it came. That's the image that I have of God. And to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Job declared in Job chapter 2 that when a man dies, that his body goes back to the dust from which it comes. He says, the Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the name of God. When you put your loved one in the ground, you didn't put his spirit in the ground. See, the reason that you're so sad is that you think that the flesh is everything. Don't you know you can't capture his spirit? You might cough in my body, but my spirit lives on the other side. And that's enough to say amen and thank you, Jesus. What you crying for? That's just flesh and blood going back from which it came. I understand that not only is my flesh going back to the ground, but my soul waits for judgment, and my soul is going to receive the eternal blessing from God, either on one side or the other, and I must do everything to establish my soul's condition, which is a direct derivative of what I've done in my flesh. Somebody say amen. And see, folk be playing too much. See, because I'm in the flesh, I make a connection with the world because I'm in the flesh. That's why I can be in the world, not of the world, because one of the senses that I have is touch. And I can be touched in a pleasurable way or a painful way because I'm in my flesh. I spend most of my time taking care of my flesh. Yesterday, I spent $20. And no sense for a fresh haircut. Somebody say amen. Because I want to take care of my flesh. I wear Dolce and Gabbana cologne because that's my trademark. Amen. Because I want to smell good in my flesh. I don't wear anything but Italian wool suits. I don't wear rayon, and I don't wear polyester. But I have to have the best for my flesh. Y'all look at me like you don't take care of your flesh. Looking out there, I see some mighty expensive shoes for some ugly feet. Can you say amen? I see nice shirts and sweaters because we are connected within our flesh, and we take care of our flesh. And sometimes in my flesh, I have to realize that my flesh is more than just my skin. skin, but it is an entity that moves and breathes and can cause reaction in my spiritual world. And you got to realize that when you're talking to me, that you would rather speak to my spirit than my flesh. Because my flesh is sensuous, my flesh is selfish, my flesh is arrogant, my flesh only cares about me. And if you make a mind, if there are two pieces of meat on the table, I can eat both of them. If you don't get there, you won't get your meat. Amen. Because our flesh naturally is responsive, according to Pablo, in the sense that when we are in danger, our flesh intuitively wants to survive, while our spirit wants to return to be back with the Lord. While our spirit has no fear of death, our flesh wants to thrive and live. If you went underwater just for a moment, you would grasp and reach for the top of the water because your flesh instinctively wants to live. But I can't be too hard on myself because I'm flesh. I'm a spirit. I live in my what? In my flesh. And I possess a soul. But Paul says that if you are led by the Spirit, then ye shall walk in the Spirit. But if you are led by the flesh, you will reap the corruption that flesh will produce. So when we look at the text and understanding that one of these forces in the text is either leading you, taking you where you desire to go by the decision that you made, you can understand Paul's gravity when he writes to the church in Galatians. He expresses to them that the arguments and the problems that we're having in the church is not because God's word is wrong. It's because somebody is in their flesh. Amen. And he said, and part of the problem is that when you in your flesh, we try to cover it by acting like it's a spiritual concern. Amen. The argument in the text is whether or not circumcision is required for the Gentiles. Paul is suggesting by your sinful nature, because these folks are not Gentiles, you think that they ought to be practicing Judaism, but Judaism has been nailed to the cross, and we are now all Christians, whether we are Jew or Gentile, whether we are bond or free, whether we are male or female, we have all been baptized into Christ. Yeah, yeah, yeah. But the argument is covered in a spiritual connotation. And hence the letter here in the book of Galatians. So, as we answer this question, what's leading me? I realize that the flesh can lead because the Bible makes that pointedly clear. The Bible says in the book of Romans chapter 7 and verse number 18, that I know that in me, that is in my flesh, dwelleth no good thing. I realize the flesh has no positive results. As good as I treat it and as nice as I take care of it, if I have a beautiful flesh and an ugly spirit, I'm in trouble. Am I right about it? I can look and I can see that the Bible declares in Romans 8 and verse number 5 that they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh. Now say with me, I'm a spirit. I live in flesh and I possess a soul. I realize that in my flesh there is no good thing. I have to be watchful and mindful that when I start to frown up and roll my eyes at folk, that is not my spirit, that's my flesh. Because the spirit don't act like that. When I begin to behave certain ways, I need to quit lying on God to my, you affected my spirit. No, that's your flesh rearing up. You mean and you cussing right now because you in your flesh. The spirit don't manifest itself. It provides fruit of itself. Yeah, stop right there. Stop right there because if you can't see That when you're in your flesh, nothing good's gonna come out of it. You're not gonna know when to be quiet and when to talk. But when you begin to, sometime, baby, when you're going through something, when you know you're in your flesh and your blood pressure's up and your eyes are sticking out your head and your hair is starting to tighten up and you're starting to get red in your eye, that's not the time to have a conversation with somebody. That's the time to seek consultation from the Spirit, because if your flesh start talking, it's going to say some stuff it ought not say.
Amen.
But if I'm walking around and all I can do is see what's affecting my flesh, I'm going to be in a world of trouble, and I'm always find myself in retreat because my flesh done messed me up again. And just because I mess up in my flesh don't mean that my spirit was in agreement with my flesh.
Amen.
I can have a bad battery in a car, but don't tear up the car. Somebody ought to say amen. You don't throw away your car because you need a transmission. You still got a good engine. Sometimes you got to get rid of the other stuff and keep driving the car. Y'all looking at me funny. And so then, I knew what you want to be like. I still got 10 more minutes out of the transition. Now watch this. I realize that in me there is no good thing. And I can't worry about your flesh, because your flesh don't care about nothing but you, like my flesh don't care nothing about me. And so when folks say that you affected me, what you really mean is that my flesh is upset with you right now, because your spirit does not produce fruit that act like you're responding. And so the Bible says, now watch this, here's the war. 1 Corinthians chapter 2. Verse number 14, here's the war right here. And I'm going to be ready to preach in just a minute. Here's the war right here. Because if you can get this, you can go home and be in control of yourself. Have you ever felt like you just lost control? That you just I just keep making the same mistake over and over again. Y'all ought to tell the truth. You ever wonder why every Sunday morning is just a struggle to get out of bed? You know what time it is. You know Bible class at 8:30. That's sure early in the morning to your flesh, ain't it? Get up at 8:30. You better not call me at 8:30 in the morning and do what? Can somebody hear your flesh? Have you noticed that when you get to church, that you find yourself trying to pay attention and trying to tune into the lesson because your flesh ain't trying to hear something spiritual? Amen. Do you notice when you get mad, you move from what you see? You used to sit in the front row, but now you mad. And you get yourself up and move to the back row. Well, you can roll your eyes and show your disgust to the whole world. Now, some of y'all just sit in the back all the time. Ever since I've known you, you sit in the back of church. I'm not talking to you. And I met you over on that street, you were sitting on the back. I'm not talking to you. I call them my backup people. And they sit back in the back, they can hear you talking, they call and tell me. You're back there talking to you in Hamilton.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Back there in the ear. Amen. I'm talking about the folk that transition from the back, from the front to the back. You're not moving there because you're spiritual. You're moving because you're in your what? You're in your flesh. And here's the problem. Here's the problem in the text. It is hard to communicate with somebody that's in their flesh. And I want to encourage you that the question is not so much who's wrong or who's right. The question is what's leading and guiding the conversation or the activity. Are you with me right now? Because if one of us or both of us in our flesh, the Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse number 14, the Bible says what? The natural man, the fleshly man.
The Spirit of God.
Hold on, man, back up again. I want you to read that. So the natural man.
But the natural man receiveth not.
He receiveth not.
The things of the Spirit.
The things of the Spirit of God. See, here's the problem. This way you know the flesh is leading. If we have an issue or a problem, and I present you with something spiritual, and you in your flesh, you can't even hear me when I'm talking to you. The only thing you can see is my flesh. So rather than come up with a solution that's spiritual, we spend hours and miles and months talking about both of our flesh. The reason husband and wives can't get it together is because they don't seek a spiritual resolution, but they're having a fleshly conversation covered in the spiritual fact that we are married. And so we try to warn each other, and we'll say to one another, if you keep on, you're going to make me act a fool. Amen. That's a warning. And when you're spiritual, you hear that stuff. In other words, they're saying to you, I'm about to get in my flesh. And sometimes they say, I'm not no killer, but don't push me. And that's all right, because you need to be aware when folks are pushing to their flesh and when they're in their spirit. Because when folk get in their flesh, they'll do something to you. Am I right about it? And every one of us get in our flesh every now and again. And I'm just honest about it. I'll tell you, when I'm getting in my flesh, you better quit. And then y'all say, well, what are you saying? Because I can tell the truth and say in the church. If you can't recognize what's leading you, when you mad and you frowned up talking about what you ain't gonna do, what you gonna do, when you gonna do it, how you gonna do it, that is your flesh talking and not your spirit. But when your spirit leads, we say, whatever God takes me, whatever God shows me, whatever God points me to, that will I do. However you can use me, Lord, use me. That you listen to your spirit. And so then the Bible says, in your flesh, you can't hear no sermon in your flesh. And it hit me that some of us, like the text, have legally come to church every Sunday and had heard a word because they came in their flesh. They sit in the pews and are still talking about circumcision and still talking about Judaism and still talking about thatism and every idiosyncrasy you can think of, and had heard one sermon, and it dawned on me, because folk come to church don't mean they're spiritual. And sometimes folk come to church in their flesh and they can't receive the things of God. So when I start talking about doing stuff the way God says to do it, it's foolishness. It's foolishness under them. What you mean, Gil? What you mean without a saying? What you mean, let's turn up the value? What you mean, lift your hands to God? Watch this, everybody in your spirit, can you lift your hands to God right now and give God glory and praise in the name of Jesus? Oh, I see some spiritual folks. It's talking to spiritual folks right now. If you're in your flesh, keep your hand down. Praise God for you. We don't want you to miss our spiritual stuff. Praise God. Praise God anyway. Hallelujah. Y'all already know, there's no difference in flesh and spirit, right?
Amen.
What's leading you this morning? On Monday, what leads you? What drives you? What moves you? I don't know. I don't know how to tell. But then Paul gives some insight. Paul says, the work, now watch how he does this. He says, the work of the flesh are manifested. Now this is manifested, meaning that it's homegrown inside of you. It's manifested, and it are these. The flesh will lead you to adultery. The flesh will lead you to fornication. The flesh will lead you, it'll lead you from fornication on to uncleanness and lasciviousness. That means just anything you can do. The flesh will lead you from lasciviousness on over to wrath. The flesh will lead you, it'll take you to places you never thought you would go. The flesh, you can move back to Galatians chapter 5 now. The flesh will lead you to lasciviousness. The flesh will lead you into anger. It'll lead you into witchcraft. It'll lead you to illuminations. It'll lead you to variances, it'll lead you to wrath, it'll lead you to strife and sedition. What's sedition? Sedition is division. What's division? Division is when we decide that I got a way, which is circumcision, and you have a way, which is Christianity, and we both say they're both Christianity, but you want me to practice circumcision like you want me to practice circumcision, and I'm moving because I don't know where I'm going, for I walk by faith and not by sight. 2 Corinthians 5:7, I believe that when we're in Christianity, we move by the Spirit, because it's in Him we move and breathe. I don't know what I'm going to preach from one day to another, but the Spirit knows, and whatever the Spirit says, I move toward. What's our real problem? The real problem is not circumcision. It's not Christianity. The problem is that I'm in my flesh, and it's moved me to sedition, and sedition will produce heresy. And heresy is false doctrine or a false claim about the Scriptures. And Paul said in Galatians 1:6, he said, let me tell you something. If any man come and he bring not this doctrine, he said, let him be accursed. For do I now persuade man, or do I persuade God? For if I begin to persuade man, I become an enemy to God. But what you saying, when the flesh leads you, it leads you away from God, away from God's blessing, away from God's glory, away from God's place, and it puts you in a place of heresy, division, wrath, witchcraft, zodiac signs, and everything else. Amen. Have you ever been in your flesh? Do you know when it manifests itself? It manifests itself, listen to it, strife and sedition, heresy. And he said, let me break it down this way. He said, envy and murders, once you, look how they all tie together. Strife, sedition, heresy. They all go together. Once you get into heresy, you become envious. Why are you envious? They were envious of Paul. They were envious of Paul because Paul stood on the doctrine of Christ. And Paul